Hello, my lovelies, and welcome back. Long time no see. I have another amazing guest tonight. It took me a while until he had time to come on the channel, but I'm very, very happy and excited. We finally made it. This is a Sunday we're recording this, so yes, thank you for taking time of your real life, Josh, from the amazing Talking Law channel, which I told Josh a while ago that I'm a fan of his channel, and I don't watch that much talking content, but I do watch his. So I can only tell everybody, if you like this format we're doing here right now, and if you like a deep dive into all the good things Talking and also Silmarillion, this is what I cover here, go and follow Josh. And yes, there are many, many good videos I can recommend. And Josh, introduce yourself.
So yeah, I mean, I have the Talking Lore channel, and it's, you know, most of what I do obviously is Middle Earth related, but I talk about stuff outside the Middle Earth context. I mean, pretty much anything related to Tolkien I'll cover. Mm-hmm. I've done videos on his other writings like Farmer Giles of Ham, Smith of Wootton Major, Beowulf, I mean, you name it. And I've gotten a little bit into some of his own life, you know, stuff like that. Sooner or later, I'm going to start doing videos on some of his letters. I've kind of touched on that with my Valentine's Day video earlier this year, because I got into like his letter that he wrote to Michael, his son, about his advice on romance and stuff like that. So I'm kind of touching on that already, but eventually I want to get more into it. Because, I mean, if you actually read his letters, and it's a huge volume, it's like this thick.
It is.
There's some really fascinating stuff in those letters. I mean, it gets really interesting. Some of them are not, obviously, but a lot of them are just tremendously fascinating reading on their own. So anything Tolkien goes on my channel.
Would you? I love that, because it's very similar to what I do. Although I really try to focus on First and Second Age and the time before the sun rose. Do you reckon? Would you say that this is law? This is canon for you, what he wrote in his letters, because you know, if you read the book or a few of his letters, he contradicts himself and he retells the story. And I mean, this is his, you know. Good on him, because obviously he wrote that many, many years ago, and then people wrote to him, asked him questions, and he rethought, this is very human, this is what we do in our lives and in our jobs, right? You can change your opinion. I mean, most of us don't have a book that half the world has read and has knowledge on, and then we have to change stuff we, you know, like we told them our facts. But do you count that as canon, or what would you say?
So my theory on canon is probably not as well developed as it should be, but I, generally speaking, when I think of the canon of Tolkien, the only official canon is like The Hobbit and Lord of the Rings, and then the Silmarillion is kind of semi-canon because, of course, Christopher Tolkien edited a lot of that. And beyond that, everything else is like, there are some things that I like to think are the true canon, but can't really definitively say. Whenever Tolkien writes in a letter, in some ways, I think that's more canon than things that are in, say, the Unfinished Tales, because in the Unfinished Tales, it really is an unfinished story that he never put down in a final form. Yeah. And even though the letter stuff doesn't get published in any of his stories either, he is, in some sense, in at least some of them, telling people definitively, this is the truth.
Yeah.
Although even
and
there,
he answers open questions sometimes.
Yeah, and I mean, really interesting. And sometimes he doesn't. Like, somebody asked him once, like, what happened to the Ent wives? And he's like,
no.
I don't know.
Yeah.
And one of the things that I really like about his style of filling in the gaps, and this is something that I really picked up from listening to Corey Olson, the Tolkien professor, he doesn't do, like, making up more stuff to go in his stories for the most part. A lot of the time, when he's answering those kinds of questions, what he's really doing is reading his own stories and going, okay, what are the logical implications of that? What does that mean for, you know, answering this particular question that I didn't specifically address in all these other stories?
Yeah.
Now, that's not to say that he didn't put in a bunch of other stuff that was just inserted just, you know, from whole cloth, more or less. Because, I mean, a lot of the stuff in the Unfinished Tales really does cover stuff that never comes up anywhere else that he had to invent whole cloth. But a lot of the time what he's doing is literally just taking, he's acting like a really good reader of his own work. And I think that that's a really interesting way for an author to behave.
It is, and it is also that he's widening the world, you know, and this is just like today, when our world gets more and more connected, you know, things sometimes don't match up, but then you have to find an explanation for readers who then read everything. You want to give them that explanation, and yeah, it is hard to keep. I mean, look at George R. R. Martin. I mean, that guy must have a big whiteboard, you know, with many, you know, like arrows pointing at each other. And you know what I mean? Maybe you know the meme I'm talking about. I think that's Steve Konecki or someone, you know, like pointing
at different... I'm not sure I've seen that specific one, but I mean, yeah. I've seen a lot of the ones where... Are you talking about like the one where it shows different fantasy stories and how all the lines interconnect?
Yes, and
the
then
stories?
They all connect. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I've seen some like it. I don't know if I've seen the specific one you're talking about, but I've seen some like it. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that is talking, but that is the you know, the magic about him. And just imagine, I can always say that because I literally couldn't make a video in 2 weeks because I had my real life job. But that man, literally, you know, he was a professor. He had a family. He wrote books on the side. So, you know, we have to like give that man a break if he can't answer everything and if he makes some mistakes and gets back to stories. And if some dates are mixed up and all that, I'm not mad about that. And I think everybody can find their own explanation and their own truth. And that is, I don't like people who come at you and are like, oh, but this is wrong. Because no, for me, literature is art. And art, there are no rules. Do what, you know, like think whatever you're somebody from America, you perceive a story completely different than me growing up in Europe because we have different backgrounds. We, you know, that is totally normal. And that's the beauty of art and literature. So.
Yeah,
good. I mean,
your cultural background makes a huge difference, and if you know enough about Tolkien, you can see why, because he knew about all these other cultures.
He did. He studied them, and he knew. Yes, good. But people, we. Made sure we took it and ran with it. But we're here today actually to talk about the twins, the twin brothers, Elrond and Elros. Yes, and this is a very exciting topic we agreed on, Josh and I. And I do think, although they are so important for the story, I don't know if people really know that much about their actual lives. Before, especially the lives before they split up and what happened to them in their youth, because this is very important for whatever comes afterwards, right? So what do you find, first of all, reconnecting all this and summing maybe their stories up, what do you find, what is the most intriguing, most fascinating thing about the twin brothers separately or together for you overall?
Well, so the interesting thing, of course, is when he's first developing the Silmarillion way back in the early 1900s, there's only Elrond at first. Elros doesn't even come on the scene until he starts developing the Numenor mythology much later. And so the role that Elrond plays is kind of like he's the continuation of the First Age into the latter days of the world. And of course, the Silmarillion for Tolkien is just a mythology of Earth's history. So when he's thinking of the continuation of the Silmarillion or the First Age into latter history, he's thinking literally in terms of, you know, there's this mythology of what the Earth was like many, many years ago when there was still elves and magic around in the world, and now they're not here. But Elrond is like a question mark on that. He's like a, you know, somebody from that time was left in Middle Earth who did not return into the West with the rest of the elves. And so therefore, what, you know, to what extent is the First Age in some way still among us even now? You know, that's kind of what it is. And then of course that develops into both Elrond and Elros, with Elros being the brother who chooses the mortal path, whereas Elrond chooses to be an elf. Elros becomes the first king of Numenor. And so you've still got that same theme, but it now has its, instead of being Elrond being the combination of the elves and men of the First Age continuing on, he still is because he's still part man and part elf. But now those two paths have kind of diverged, and Elrond is primarily representing the elves of the First Age continuing on, and Elros is representing the men of the First Age carrying on. And that, of course, becomes Numenor. And then those lines, of course, reconverge eventually in The Lord of the Rings. Well, at the end of The Lord of the Rings, when Aragorn marries Arwen, because Aragorn is descended more directly from Elros, and Arwen from Elrond.
So it's basically a ring, you know? Reconnect.
Everything is a ring.
It is, yeah. I hope it's not Morgoth's ring, so that would be bad. No, but I find that fascinating. And I always thought, and I don't know if you would agree to that, because we know that Earendil is literally where it started for Tolkien, right? And who is Earendil? It's their father. There are many, many things I found so beautiful and symbolic of the story of Earendil playing out in his twins, in his children, his only children, by the way. And I always had the feeling that Elros, because we know Earendil would have chosen the human fate, right? I think this is pretty clear that he would have loved to stay or become, I mean, depends on how you see it, a human. And then he has this, but he, for his wife and for the, literally the sake of the world, because he is still up there, right, in the skies, and he sacrificed humanity. It sounds weird, but he kind of did for his wife. And then his twin sons have this choice again, right? And one chooses, as you say, but his life is very, I find Elrond very sorrowful. He has to say goodbye, and we'll come to that later, but he, just imagine, he has to say goodbye to so many people in his life. He's losing friends. He's losing his wife. Not really losing, they will reunite, but for a long, long time, he's losing his wife. He sacrifices that. He is losing his children in the end, because we know, Arwen stays behind, his twin sons stay behind, as far as we know. He has to say goodbye to his children, to his brother. He'll never see his brother again. And all that, you know, it's very sorrowful. Then there's Elros, his twin, which is the human fate. And I don't know, I always feel that Elros' choice was actually the better choice. I think Tolkien wanted to give Earendil in a way this choice back and show and portray it and mirror it in his son Elros, who chose the human fate. Do you see it like that?
Well, it's interesting, because if you think about Earendil for his choice, right? In the Silmarillion, it kind of specifically tells us that the reason he wants to choose humanity over being an elf is because his father, Tuor, was a man. Which is interesting, because the Silmarillion also tells us that Tuor sailed west, and it is believed among some people that he actually was accepted among the elves. So we don't get any hints of whether they actually end up back together after all, which Earendil probably doesn't end up back together with Tuor, because he's sailing up in the sky and not actually living in Valinor. But it's interesting, because Earendil's choice is informed by his own parent. And Elrond and Elros don't get that kind of, they don't have anything to inform their choice in that same way. And so, you know, going back to that original point about Elrond was originally the only child of Earendil, and Elros was a later kind of, I don't want to say concept, afterthought, but he kind the fact that Elrond ends up being the one who is the only child and chooses the path of, you know, being an elf, at least presumably. I don't think it actually specifically says in the Silmarillion which he chooses.
You don't see that choice moment of his.
Right. But presumably he is, you know, chosen to be an elf. And so it's really interesting to see how that all plays out, because Tuor kind of goes the elven route, even though he's a man and doesn't have the choice. Earendil then takes the choice of being an elf because of his wife, and then Elrond chooses elf without really knowing what happened to any of these people at all. So Elros's choice is always kind of the most interesting one, because in a way it almost seems like it was just the narrative kind of determining what had to be the case. And it's the reason for that. And if you actually look at the history of the development of the Numenor legend,
Yeah.
Elrond is originally considered as the king of Numenor.
Yes.
Like he wasn't that in the original Silmarillion writings, but when Tolkien finally develops the Numenor legend, he's like, okay, Elrond can be the king of Numenor.
Yeah.
But then he ends up determining, wait, that doesn't really work. That's not what I want. I'm going to have a twin brother for Elrond, and he's going to be the man who becomes the first king of Numenor.
Mm-hmm.
So it almost seems like a narrative-driven choice.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, within the story itself, what do we have to decide as far as, you know, why would Elros make that choice in the first place? It's hard to say because we get so little of their childhood. Like, we get the impression almost that one, you know, Arendelle has the kids, but then he's gone almost all their lives sailing, trying to get into the West. So what do they, how much do they know of their father? How much do they know of their grandparents? It's hard to say, but presumably they both know who Tuor was and, you know, all that, because Elwing at least could have told them.
They must, because remember, some Numenorean king, and I don't think it was Ar-Pharazôn, it must have been before him. They reference, okay, but look, Earendil, my ancestor, and don't quote me where she's actually from. I think it's from Unfinished Tales. I'm not 100% sure. Earendil, my ancestor, also went to the Undying Lands, and it was okay for him to go there. So they must know the story. There's a quote on one of the Numenorean kings. I don't think it was Ar-Pharazôn.
I think it's in the Akalabeth, but I don't think it's Ar-Pharazôn. I think it's...
No, it was not Ar-Pharazôn. It was... Exactly.
Yeah.
So they must know...
I mean, it's obviously known in the history.
Yes, exactly. So, and if you remember then later, you know, Elrond was the one, he literally had, this is how I imagine Imladris, a big, big library, you know, I mean, my personal dream, where he has the accounts of Numenor, because we know the Numenoreans, they were so kind of ashamed, you know, that the line of the faithful of what happened in Numenor, they wanted, this is what I felt, they wanted to forget what happened there and literally start anew in Middle-earth. I mean, yes, you know, then they build Ar-Pharazôn this statue and everything, but it's always said like the shameful deeds of Ar-Pharazôn the Golden, and so in a way Elrond, you know, kept this memory of his brother, of the line of his brother and the Numenorean kings alive, as one of the only ones, because the Dúnedain, they didn't have that many songs about the Numenoreans, and they didn't teach the history of the Numenoreans. They talk about Ar-Pharazôn and his pompous armada. I think that's how they...
Well, and that's the other interesting thing about Elrond too, is not only does he have to say goodbye to so many people, but he keeps having these nephews pop up into his life, like over and over and over and over and over and over. And it's you have to wonder what that would be like. But then again, somebody who lives forever, they would have a very different perspective on that.
Yeah, do you have on the Aragorn, because we don't know, maybe we will tell you now. So the twin brothers, when they were very, very young, their parents, you know, that the War of Wrath, I think it was, yes, right, happened, and this is what we said, you know, before the War of Wrath, sorry, the Havens of Sirion, where they were born and where they lived with their parents when they were very young, were attacked by the last surviving sons of Fëanor, because some have died earlier attacking Doriath, and they wanted to reclaim the Silmaril, so their mother had the Silmaril because she's a descendant of the line of Beren and Lúthien. So she inherited basically the Silmaril. And they attacked the Havens. And so their parents went and left. This is actually a tragic and horrible fate for the two twin boys. But they were spared by the brothers, by two of the sons of Fëanor. And they fostered them. And, I mean, they could have easily killed them. They did so many bad and evil deeds that wouldn't, I mean, that would just have added up to a long, long list, right? But they didn't. So they fostered them. And then later, Elrond also becomes a foster father to what you just said. You know, he, again, history repeats itself, that he's fostering the descendants of the line of the faithful, of his twins, descendants, basically.
Yeah, and it, which I'm trying to remember, I meant to look this up before we got started and I ended up not having time, but which brother was it that ended up fostering specifically Elros and Elrond?
Maglor,
okay.
Yeah.
And if I remember correctly, he's the one who ends up like spending the whatever remaining years he has just singing on the coastline, yeah, bewailing his fate.
Yeah.
So you have to wonder, like, how long did he foster them actually? I don't think we have a really clear timeline of the events such that we could say it was X number of years between when he started, yeah, fostering them and when he, you know, ran away with the Silmaril and ended up not really.
Exactly. I mean, we know when the attack on the Havens of Sirion, I don't really know, First Age, whatever, happened. But yeah, you're right. We don't. What we know is, apparently, Maglor was one of the only sons of Fëanor. You know, because that bloody line. I mean, thank God it died out in the end. But they not many of them were married. I mean, they were busy fighting wars and killing their kin. And so he was said to be, he was the second oldest son after Medros, and he was said to be married, but we don't know of any offspring. So probably he didn't have offspring, because that would mean there could still be, you know, Noldorian princes around, and there are none. So I don't really know, but yes, he fostered them, and we know he kind of, it is said about him that he is the one that resembled most, Nerdanel is the mother? Yeah, Nerdanel, I think.
Right,
he resembled most in temper the mother, so it makes sense.
Which would make him the more sympathetic.
Yes.
Which even Maedhros, by the end of it, of course, was kind of like weary of the whole project and like, I'm just done with this. But, those two were the best of all seven.
Yes.
But they, you know, that didn't get in the way of them doing horrible things, of course.
No, they didn't learn anything. They attacked the Havens again for the bloody Silmaril, for an oath. This is literally the third kinslaying. The third.
Yeah. Right, and the third one that failed to achieve its purpose, by the way.
Exactly. Which, and
the other interesting thing about that, too, is this is, again, going back to that whole idea of the fostering. Mm-hmm. You know, the reason Maglor ends up doing it is because in the previous kinslaying in Doriath, they left the two twins, was it twin sons or twin daughters of Dior to die in the woods. And so it's like almost in a penance for that he takes on Elrond and Elros, which is interesting in part because the fact that it was twins the first time, and I think it was always, I may be misremembering my history of Middle Earth, but I think it was always twins, but it was not always twin sons of Eärendil, which is interesting because you'd think Tolkien would have kept the parallel up the whole time, but in fact he didn't. Now I may be misremembering that, but anyway.
I think it was sons. So Elured and Elurin, something like that.
Right.
Yes, but
it's
was
been a while
twin
since
sons.
I read Book of Lost Tales.
Yep. Twin sons again.
You know,
which would.
Right. And so it's interesting that parallel didn't, I mean, it's parallel to a degree, but the fact that it wasn't originally Elrond and Elros, it was only Elrond kind of breaks the parallel, which is interesting. But regardless, you know, Maglor, after the really heinous evil of leaving those two to die in the woods, decides he's going to foster these two and kind of make up for that in a way. Mm-hmm. And it's, the interesting thing about it is the Silmarillion actually says that they develop a really good relationship together, which is really interesting because they literally just wiped out most of their people. Mm-hmm. You know, the Maglor and Maedhros wiped out what pretty much what remained of the their people scared their mother off so that she's gone. Yeah. And yet Elrond and Elros both end up with apparently a good relationship with them. We don't get any detail as to how that worked out, but it's at least interesting to think about.
Yeah. I don't know. I told last time on Dan's Voice of Geekdoms channel, I told people that I was born in Transylvania. I know a lot about, East European history. I'm partly East European, and that is very a common thing. You know, the Turks attacked the eastern parts of Europe, or even Austria, many, many times. They were literally in front of the borders of Vienna once. And it was a very common thing that houses, I don't really know George R. R. Martin that well. I think he has kind of a similar story in his books as well. But houses that have been defeated sometimes send their elder sons or sons in regular, in general, to the enemies who won battles or whatever, and they were raised by enemy houses. That happened really, really often in Europe during medieval time or even later. And it is a very similar concept Tolkien uses here. Just reminded me of that a little bit.
Yeah,
and happened to the real Dracula, to Count Dracula, who was a real person, not made up by Bram Stoker, and Vlad Tepes was his name, and he was raised by a Turkish, I don't really remember that guy's name, but kind of an emperor, and by that family, which is
right. Well, and that's actually. To connect this to Tolkien a little bit more, Luke Evans, of course, who plays Bard, played
Vlad Tepes in
that movie.
He did.
And that was his backstory, was that he was raised as more or less a brother to the guy who he ends up killing in the movie.
Yeah.
But of course, one major difference between what happens with Elrond and Elros and those kinds of instances in history is Elrond and Elros weren't exactly being transferred as what are essentially hostages, which is a lot of what the historical examples were. That was more like, we're going to keep your kid in our place so that you don't try to rebel, which you can see why, however, even though they're being held as hostages, they would still be treated with at least a certain degree of respect and kindness because you don't want that person to then become like your absolute worst enemy when you finally have to put him on the throne as your vice regent, because you want those people to remain subjugated.
Yes,
and if you
and
just absolutely
the
make their leader hate you, it's not going to work.
Not 1,000%. And this is, what happened to Germanic tribes. Often the Romans who conquered Germanic tribes, they took in the boys and then they grew up as Roman soldiers. And then they went back to, wasn't Germany then, but and then they went back and had all the knowledge of their enemy, and obviously then you can defeat them. But again, as you said, this is not what happened with the twin boys. But you talked about the Silmaril and Meglor in the end wandering the shores of Middle-earth, which is such a cool image, and that was actually one of my questions I had for you. Do you think is he still, because we know all the others died. So Olofernos' brood, all the sons, died out, and with Celebrimbor, actually his last descendant died. So the line ended with Celebrimbor. But we don't know what happened to Meglor. We don't know. Is he still wandering the shores? I think the book says he got forgotten, or his memory is no longer something like that. I find it so cool because, talking about the Silmarils, Earendil is the shining star in the sky, right? And what ring did Elrond get, right? He got the ring of air, basically. So he has, but basically, because all the three Silmarils mirror the three elven rings. So there's the ring of fire, there's the ring of water, and there's the ring of air. And this is exactly where this three Silmarils disappeared. One Silmaril is still in the sky, in the air, and he got the ring where his what his father symbolizes, basically, and his mother. And then the ring of fire got cast in a volcano. So it disappeared in a volcano. And the third ring is the ring of water. And that's the Silmaril he cast into, Meglo cast into the sea. So again, everything is connected and mirrors, like the three elven rings mirror the three Silmarils.
Right. Well, and interesting, I'm reading back through the History of Middle-earth volumes that cover the Lord of the Rings specifically. And originally, Galadriel's ring was the Ring of Earth, not the Ring of Water.
I know.
Which is interesting. But it just as a
because
side note.
Because she was the preservate, you know, because she preserved, that was the ring that preserved Lorien. And
But as for Maglor's fate, it is kind of hard to say because it's kind of intentionally vague. Yeah. But I mean, you could almost see him working in a very fairy tale like connection with him, because it's like, you know, not just the sighing of the waves, but you know, on the shores you might hear something that sounds almost like sad singing, and that might be like Maglor's spirit still wandering houseless on the shores of Earth. And you know, so you
and he might
look at
hear
that
all the Teleri that he killed, you know, the screams of all the Teleri that he basically killed in the Kingslaying. Also very symbolical because
true. Because one of the things that we are told, and I don't remember what volume this is in, but you can, as an elf, resist the summons to the halls of Mondos, and your spirit can just remain in Middle Earth and you know, do whatever. The only other real significant possibility that I can think of for Maglor is that over time in his, you know, sorrow, he did what Luthien did and just faded and died of his grief. Those seem to me the two most likely, you know, kinds of approaches. And either one of them kind of works the same way. I mean, it's the point is he ends his life basically futilely grieving for his own stupidity. It's basically what it comes to.
That bloody curse and oath, basically. It's so mean that a father does this to his. I'll make a fan of video, but that video will be like 5 hours long because I have a lot to say about him.
There is much to be said.
It is. And don't get me wrong, I find him such an interesting character. And if you know that in the beginning, he wasn't actually that important. Tolkien didn't write him as that important character that he later became. And it's so cool how that character developed over time and how important his descendants and all of them got. I have another question for you. Would you say, because we talked about the kings of the about elven kings, right, and elven kingdoms, and I mean Elrond founded Rivendell, and would you say after Gil-galad died, the last High King of the Noldor died, do you think, and we know this is always or mostly the line of the father, as what the elf identifies with, which house for the elves that, you know, have various houses in them, which this line definitely has. If you look at the family tree, it's they combine, and even later on, you know, when Galadriel and Celebrion comes into the game, and so Elrond's children literally combine all the houses and lines of men and elves in them, which it makes that bloodline so powerful. So do you think does he identify as Noldor? So could he have taken over? Because his brother became the king of Numenor. Elrond never, he was the lord of Rivendell. That is very different from taking on a kingship.
Right. Well, and I think in a lot of ways, the end of the Noldoran kingdom in Middle-earth is kind of parallel to the end of Arnor in the north, because you know, when Gil-galad dies, there is no actual heir to the kingship at that point. Elrond may be the last and greatest of the Noldoran lords, and I mean, you could say that he's not Noldorin because he's got, you know, he's got Telerin because of his ancestry. I mean, if anything, if he's an heir to anything, he's an heir to the kingdom of Doriath, which obviously doesn't exist. It's under the sea at this point. But, yeah. You know,
he even has Vanya in him. He even has Vanya blood in him.
Right. I mean, he's got everything.
Yeah.
Sooner or
and
later.
Maiar.
Because he's got. Yeah. I mean, he is. And that goes back to what we were talking about at the very beginning. He is, you know, in a sense, Eärendil is the culmination of the First Age.
Yes,
yeah. And Elrond is what passes to the remainder because he has, he's got Min, he's got Noldor, he's got Teleri, he's got Vanya, and he's got Maia. He's literally got every possible strain that you could have at some point in his past. Yep. And so, you know, he is carrying all of those things forward, but I think in a way that's kind of what makes him not the king of anything, because he is in some way representative of everybody, and that's why his role, to the extent that it gets developed in the Lord of the Rings, is as a lore master. He is the memory. He is literally a living memory of everything that's gone before.
Yeah.
And, you know, we even hear in the Council of Elrond, he talks about, I remember, you know, even the War of Wrath. You know, he's old enough to remember what that was like. So he obviously didn't live through most of the First Age, but he knows of it. And everything since the War of Wrath, he actually knows in his own memory. And that goes for things for men, things for elves of all kinds, the whole shebang. So he's got a little bit of everything. And, you know, he's got, in a sense, a claim to the heirship of Thingol and Doriath. He's not an heir to any of the kingships of the Noldor except Turgon, which Turgon was never high king. I mean, he kind of was, in a sense, de facto high king. In name,
he was, but he cared more about Gondolin, so he didn't really.
Well, and he was so cut off from the rest of the elves at that point that what was he going to do? Reveal Gondolin so that he could proclaim his kingship? I mean, that's not.
No.
That wouldn't work.
No, so same with Finrod. Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, he could never really claim that, even though after the death of Fingon, he sort of was.
Yeah.
And that's why it passed to Gil-galad.
Yeah.
And then after Gil-galad, everybody's dead. There's no heirs to the Noldorin kings anymore. Mm-hmm. And like I said earlier, it kind of parallels the fall of Arnor. Eventually, you know, the line of kings of Arnor never dies.
Yeah.
But after the death of the last king, there's just not enough there to hold it together. And after the death of Gil-galad and the spending of so much of the last great strength of the Noldor in the last alliance, there's just not really an elven kingdom to have a king.
Yeah.
And so Elrond's role is not to rule, but to remember.
I love that image you gave, because this is how I see him. This is why I was talking about this library, because this is how I see Elrond. Yes, you know, he was a fighter, and Gil-galad obviously taught him, because he was a fighter, a great warrior himself. He taught him a lot of things, but this is not how I see Elrond, and I would fully agree to that he was, in a way, the memory of the world. No, I forgot what I wanted to say. I had a thought and it's gone. It will come back.
It's the downside of having two people talking.
I love this image. Yeah, let's talk about a little bit of Gil-galad, because in what I feel, he went to Gil-galad later. They were really, really close, and I feel because Elrond was really young at that time, still for an elf, right? Because we know elves, yes, even when they're 50 or whatever, they are, in our view, oh my God, 50, like they're old people. But no, they are not. I feel Gil-galad was the second foster father to him, although Gil-galad wasn't super old or that old. But, you know, he had his own experiences. He came from a different side of that family. And I love the idea that he also learned from him. So, you know, Elrond learn from so many people, and this is why maybe what you say, he had those different variations and these different memories, you know, and he's not just doesn't just identify as Noldor or whatever, but he combines all the knowledge and all the traits, good and bad, maybe, of those family, of that family tree, basically.
Yeah, I guess I've never thought of Gil-galad as like another foster father to him. And it's it's hard to say because we don't really know. We know Gil-galad has his kingdom, you know, in Lindon.
Yeah.
But we don't really know much about his interaction with Elrond until we start getting well into the Second Age and Sauron is making moves and doing stuff. Mm-hmm. So, you know, they probably were close for a long time because they would have been natural allies and everything. But, I mean, by that point, I'm not sure, and again, this goes back to the relative unclearness of Moglor's own time with Elrond and Elros. It's like, how much time did they have together? And then that was Elrond only his own, already his own, not his own man, his own elf, you know, to the extent that he wasn't. And that's, you know, certainly I think he probably would have learned from Gil-galad.
Yeah.
Because I think Elrond is probably the type to learn from literally anybody who can teach him anything. Mm-hmm. But I guess there's just not really enough there for me to go.
No, I think
that's probably true. I think it's distinctly a possibility, but it's really, I mean, there's so many gaps in the Second Age that we just don't have the ability to fill in. And that's kind of one of them.
No. Definitely. And what I find super interesting is that he never saw his brother again after Elros decided to go to Numenor. And this is, again, this very sorrowful story of his. He said goodbye to his brother. We don't know how or when. But yes, he left. And we know only 600 years later, I think with Aldarion was the first one to set foot back in Middle-earth. So 600 years after the founding of Numenor. So he can't have seen his brother. I mean, there were elves regularly going to Numenor. So maybe Elrond did, we don't really know, but I like the idea of, you know, there was in the Second Age, but almost at the end of the Second Age, when they defeated Sauron, you know, together with the Numenoreans again, he and the ancestors, the descendants, of his twin, defeated Sauron together, which is kind of cool. It's sad that it's not, you know, his brother, just somebody he probably, Elrond probably never met or met once or twice before. It's a cool image.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. And, you know, you mentioned the 600 year of the Second Age. I think that's the first time a Numenorean ship specifically hits Middle-earth again. We don't know that much about elven ships going the other way.
No.
There must have been some because presumably elves were still going to Valinor, you know, and whatnot.
Yeah.
My tendency, though, would be to think that if they were going west, they probably didn't go back east.
Yeah.
And so more than likely, once Elrond got on the boat for Numenor, that was probably the last contact they had. I mean, Elrond could have sent messages via the ships that were going west to be dropped off in Numenor, but they wouldn't be coming, bringing a message back.
No.
So that's at least my inclination on point.
Definitely. Do you think the choice his twin Elros made to become the king of Numenor, because we know he was elected, he didn't go there and claim himself the king of Numenor. This is not what happened. He kind of got elected, let's say that. But do you think this is because we know Galadriel and other Noldorians, they went to Middle-earth from Aman to claim and to have kingdoms of their own? Do you think in any way is there any similarity to Elros having that in mind to be one of the founding fathers of Numenor?
That's an interesting question. And my memory may be a little bit off, but for some reason it sticks out in my brain that Elros was more or less assigned the kingship by the Valar, not so much elected by the people. And you know, I would tend to think, if I'm remembering that right, then probably the reason for that is he's the one who's had the benefit of, you know, the wisdom imparted by, you know, Arendil, Elwing, even Moglor to the extent that he had something to impart. Yeah. And so he's going to be the one who is most capable of being the king, because I mean, if you think about it, it's a really sad thought, but by the end of the Silmarillion, most of the Edain are dead. There's not that many left, actually. And so by the time they all get to Numenor, it's not really a whole lot of people you can pick from.
No. And it was 9 ships that came there. I mean, afterwards, you know, in those 32 years they colonized Numenor, there came more people, but they were not fully Edain. We don't know where it maybe it were, you know, different races. It wasn't clear it was Edain. I think it's just those 9 ships.
Yeah. And I mean, it obviously doesn't tell us a whole lot of detail about why Elros chose and why he went to Numenor and all. Because I mean, he could have chosen to be a man and remained in Middle Earth.
That's what I mean. He could have done that. Choose to leave, knowing what will happen, right?
Yeah. So the fact that he went, and I mean, again, this kind of comes back to the idea of elves having a very different perspective on things because of their long lives. Yeah. Elros, you know, might have been informed when he made his choice, you're going to have a really, really long life for a man. And so you're going to last a while. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it may be, though this isn't filled in, that when he made his choice at that point, Eonwë or whoever was speaking for the Valar at that point basically said, you know, you would be the absolute perfect person to be king of this island we're setting up out in the West. Would you mind doing that? You'll live long enough to actually guide it for a long time, and you've got more wisdom than most of these people are going to have. So, like, you'd be the perfect candidate, and that's why he went. You know, it may not be that he went and then got chosen to be king. It may be he chose his man. He chose to go with the man line, and then the Valar, through whatever means, chose him and said, hey, you, we want you to do this, and that's why he left. It's really not clear, but that would be the way I would think it most naturally to flow.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And, you know, like somebody like Tuor, his ancestor, you know, the husband of Idril, he could have then become the king of Gondolin. And you never have, I think, especially in that line, in that side of the family, you never have that feeling, except Meglin, obviously, but, you know, you never have the feeling they strive for kingship or for all that. I just, because I recently read one of the lines about Elros preparing for this, and it kind of gave me the feeling, you know, oh, now finally somebody becomes king again, because this is what we were talking about, and now I know what I wanted to say before. It feels like with all these kings no longer being kings, but they still had a claim, they could have claimed some, you know, kingdom. It feels like this is the departure of the elves starting, the departure of Middle-earth starting, because if kingdoms fall, or not really fall, but if there is nobody who is interested in the kingship anymore, what does that mean, right? So this foreshadows that the elves will leave, and this is now the time of king of men, because what are they looking for? They are looking for kings of men, especially in the third age, right? So yeah, this is I just read it and I thought, was that maybe one of the reasons Elros did leave Middle-earth? Because like you said, he could have just stayed there and founded something else, or stayed with his brother and live out his 400 or 500 years with his brother, you know, in Rivendell or wherever. So I found that interesting, because they are from that line as well, right? And Noldorian princes, and we know they kind of went to Middle-earth for those reasons. Galadriel did. She didn't partake in the kinslaying, but she wanted lands of her own to reign over people. And that is in their blood, maybe. I don't know. It's not that Tolkien said that.
Yeah, it's hard to say how much of it is kind of innate, how much of it was Morgoth's lies, how much of it was who knows what.
Yeah.
But going back to your point, I think it's probably not a coincidence that Gil-galad, being the last king of the elves in Middle-earth, dies at the end of the second age, and then the third age is the twilight of the elves.
Yes.
You know, the first age is kind of their springtime, and then they get a really nasty late frost. And then the second age is kind of their summer. And then the third age is very definitely the twilight. And then after that, it's the time of men. And so the fact that the last kingdom, strictly speaking, of elves passes at the end of the second age is definitely a fitting coincidence, which I doubt is actually a coincidence.
No, it's not. It's not. And I always feel like Elrond kind of felt this was his duty to stay and till the kingship of men is reinstated. And so he only wanted to leave Middle-earth, you know, in the best possible, you know, like with a rightful king on the throne. I really think that he saw that as his duty in a way, not just because of his line, but he could have left earlier, right? He obviously wanted to see his wife. She was in Valinor. He didn't see his wife for a while. He didn't claim, obviously he loved Rivendell and all that, but I think he would have left earlier if he wouldn't have felt this heavy duty, and again, this is very his sorrowful side, to stay in Middle-earth, besides everything, and because he had all these memories, he saw all these wars, he saw men, he lost a bit of faith in men in his own line with, you know, the ring not being destroyed, and all that, but he stayed because he saw it as he was very dutiful, and he stayed to find the rightful king and to reinstate him on his throne. And one of the last things about Aaron I want to say, which I also find cool, and I love these mirroring things Tolkien does, because the quest for the hand of his daughter, does that remind you of something? It's different, you know, and he's not the worst dad ever, like Fingal. but does it remind
you? Yeah, let's see. How many parallels can we count?
Oh my God, I don't have enough fingers.
No,
but don't you think it's a bit similar?
Oh yeah, I mean, it's obviously pretty deliberate too. And I've done a video, and I don't even remember which video it is where I talked about this.
Okay.
But yeah, I mean, there's
maybe I stole it from you then.
I mean, there's nothing stolen anymore in the Tolkien world. Everybody's just sharing ideas, but like, and you can, it's not even just, I think it was a video that I did on parallels with his own life, because like one of the things that you can see is his own relationship with Father Morgan and Edith kind of parallels Fingal Baron and Luthien and Aragorn, Elrond and Arwen. Yeah. The parallel is not perfect in any of those cases. But it's there, and you can definitely see it's there. You know, as much as he didn't want to have his life be taken for allegory or his works be taken as allegory, there are clearly influences from his own life on, and I mean, he straight up said, you know, like, Luthien is based on Edith. I mean, that he would readily admit to, which is why on his gravestone, which is like
the gravestone,
thing ever, he's got J.R.R. Tolkien, Baron, Edith Tolkien, Luthien. Like, that right there is some romance, guys.
I've been there, by the way, Josh. I went to boarding school in Oxford, and I've been there many times. Yeah, I wanted to show last time. I showed Dan Oxford because I lived there for a few years, and it's so beautiful. If you go there, it's really, and there are a lot of people, and they take selfies there, and it's magical and beautiful if you see it with your own eyes. Yeah, I can just recommend it. Hit me up if you go there. I'll show you around.
Nice. Yeah, I've never actually been outside the contiguous 48 U.S. states. But if I ever get a passport and go overseas, it would be to the British Isles for sure.
Yes. So, hey, wait, Germany. Yeah. Germany's great.
Well, you know, I have a lot of like lineage from the British Isles, and I'm also like a really big like Scottish-Irish fan. Like, I really love Scottish and Irish history and stuff like that, and so it's just like I've got so many things that, you know, that's the first place I'm ever going, and yes, I mean before New Zealand. Much as I'd like to visit Middle Earth, you know, the British,
I guess,
would be my first choice.
Gravestone.
But yeah, going back to the parallel, I mean obviously, like you said, Elrond is not the worst dad ever like Thingol is. He's not deliberately trying to get Aragorn killed, but here we go again, back to what we were talking about at the beginning of the video. Elrond, in his time, was, you know, the passing of the torch, and now he's passing on the torch, and he wants to make sure that torch gets passed. When he tells Aragorn, only the king of Gondor and Arnor will marry my daughter, what he's saying is, I'm not going to have you marry my daughter and then you get killed and the line go away. That's not how this is going to work. If you can manage to pull all this off and more or less guarantee that the torch that I pass is not going to just get snuffed out, then we can have this thing that you want. That's kind of what I read him as saying. Like,
100%, yes. Yeah.
I don't want you to marry Arwen because I really don't want to part with her, but if you're going to marry her and she wants to choose that, it's not going to be for nothing.
No. Yeah. Which is, again, very fairy tale-like.
Good
version, not like the other version.
Yeah, not the ugly, I'm going to try to get you killed version.
Exactly. By a quest nobody can do. No.
Yeah.
Yes, cool. And one of the last thoughts I have and questions. Do you, and this is very philosophical, do you think that the concept of half-elf, and because this is what Elrond and Elros are, what's the concept of half-elven in the music of the Ainur? Was that planned all along?
You get the impression that virtually everything involving elves is part of the plan, and that it's only really as to men that the music doesn't really control things. And so I have to think probably yes. And especially because whenever Erendil comes to Valinor, Ulmo specifically says it's for this purpose that he was born. And Ulmo is planning it way back when Turgon hasn't even made it to Gondolin.
And he's still in Vinyamar.
He's like, you need to make this suit of armor specifically tailored to this guy.
Yeah.
So you get the impression that Ulmo knows from way, way back that Eärendil is going to be a person.
Yes.
And he's going to be the descendant of these people. And therefore, you can't really avoid, I don't think, the idea that half-elves are at least part of the plan.
Yeah, I agree. Although I think the Turgon thing is also thing is also part of, because he later, Eärendil was the one who pleaded with the Valar, and they were able then, due to that, to defeat Morgoth. That could have also been, you know, the plan that he wanted to roll out, basically, with giving him the armor and the information to go to Gondolin and give the message to the king of Gondolin and all that. I think that could also be the idea, but I agree. But I always thought about, you know, because Elros choose then the human fate. And as you said, humans are never in tone with the music of the Ainur. This is how I feel. I mean, explain Turin to Ramba. I mean, hello? What?
Yeah, well.
Yeah.
That's a long topic.
It is, yes. So I always thought, was that the plan all along? Like, all these people meeting in situations and how it unfolded. And I don't know the answer to that. I think it's an interesting question, but I'm more, like you saying, yes, I think the concept of half elven and this choice giving to them. And it's interesting that it happened so late in the story, actually, because elves were there for a really, really long time. And they met men, you know, like the king of Nargothrond, the friend of
Finrod.
He was friends with men, right? It could have happened way, way before. It's interesting. It's a beautiful
playing with that idea in the Othrabeth, because there he's like toying with the idea of Ignor marrying a human woman, which is the opposite of literally every case we know of
because,
you know, what we
female.
Always see is an elf woman marrying a human man. And that was the one case where he toyed with the idea of it going the other way. And he was like, nah, that's not going to work.
Yeah, but do you know why? Because I think Tolkien was a child of his time and the woman would have faded. They would have grown old. And I think Tolkien didn't want to portray this like a fading, dying woman with a man that is always the same, that always basically stays the same. He rather liked the concept of this epic warrior who in their prime met this elven woman. I think that was a way easier way to portray mortals and immortals falling in love.
Well, and also one of the other, and this is another concept that, you know, I was always kind of aware of, but as usual, Corey Olson puts it in such a neat way. The men in Tolkien almost invariably marry up.
They do.
The women are the one, and you could tell because like every woman who gets any kind of screen time at all, screen time in any of Tolkien's writings, almost invariably gets put on a pedestal. Eowyn being the only kind of gray area there, but almost all the other women are in some sense put on a pedestal, and it's the guy who is striving for that to achieve that goal. It's not the other way around. And in that sense, it's also, you know, Tolkien being kind of a product of his time because it was before the days of, you know, equal rights dating. You know, it was always the man who was courting for the woman, but he just takes it to like the fairy tale extreme of the dude wandering around trying to marry the princess. Except in his case, the princess happens to be half Maya and can do lots of really cool magical stuff and is actually the one to complete the quest for the guy.
Exactly. It was all the fairy tale princesses now getting the power with Luthien and rescuing the guy literally from the tower.
Yeah, well, rescuing him a couple times. So.
Yes, but the story of that is only together you can achieve. Just with a fellow, just like the fellowship, he couldn't, you know, reclaim the Silmaril on his own. Just together they could do it. Very fairy tale like. I'm German. I grew up with the Brothers Grimm, so I know all these stories.
Who doesn't love the Brothers Grimm?
Yeah, this is what my mom read to me. Good, Josh. This was really, really fun. I think I don't want to steal too much of your time, but do you have like a last thought why you love this story so much? But we said a bit of this in the beginning. Do you have any last thoughts on these two amazing and important to the Legendarium characters?
Well, I mean, I guess just kind of to make it a nice circle once again. just that whole idea of them being, you know, the carrying on of the torch and all this stuff. It's just another way I think that Tolkien really shows that, you know, he really understands not just how to write a good story, but how to make that story consonant with real life. Because history is cyclical in much the same way that Tolkien's stories are. And what he's showing us with Elros and Elrond is, you know, these things, these patterns keep coming up over and over again. That's not just true in fairy tale. It's true in real life. It may take a long time for that pattern to go. And in Tolkien's case, of course, the pattern takes from the end of the First Age to the end of the Third Age to repeat, in a sense. But the pattern does repeat, and it's really interesting to see how he does that. And there's lots of instances of him doing it in other small ways. But Elrond is kind of like the example of that in his own stories. And it's really also just interesting to see how when he finally just gives in to the impulse to bring The Hobbit and Lord of the Rings into the Silmarillion universe, he finds a way to make that work with Elrond by having him pass the torch on in the same exact way that Elrond was the one who got the torch at the end of the First Age.
Yeah. He's connecting it, and it totally makes sense. You're not questioning, you know, that. Yeah, yeah, it's true.
Right.
Good, yes. Now, I think they're very, and I hope, these are my hopes. I don't like to talk too much about the Amazon series because we literally don't know anything. I kind of like speculating, you know, it's fun. But yeah, this timeline we just talked about is a very, this will be the plot of the Amazon series of many, many seasons, probably. And yeah, and I do think Elrond and Elros, I don't think Elros, but because he, well, he just lived at the beginning of the Second Age, and I don't think they'll go back in time that far, because the Second Age is 3,200 whatever years, right? So that wouldn't make too much sense, but yeah. I think we'll have a like a flashback, or like, you know, him telling the story of his brother who was the founder of Numenor, something like that. I think that that will come into play. And yeah, I really, like you said, there's so many open questions, and I want the series to answer some of them. If I then accept it as canon or the truth, I don't know. But I'm just interested in how people see it, and what are the thoughts of people developing this series on these things we talk about. Yeah, because I like a bit of speculating about what Tolkien wanted this to be. And I talked to Dan last week about Celebrimbor. And this is a very similar story. You know, Celebrimbor, and many people didn't know this, he is literally there from the beginning. He was probably born in Aman, and he is a descendant of Fëanor, and he connects all the great tales. He even lived in Gondolin, which is fascinating, and many people didn't know. I'm still missing his house in the description of the houses. I mean, hello, Tolkien, what did you do? Where, like, we have the House of the Mole. You know, we have all the houses. Where's his house? He should have had a house. Even Glorfindel had one. So anyway.
Well, you don't want to give those Feanorians too much power, because then they start going crazy.
And they take over Nargothrond. So don't give them a rulership over kingdoms. No. But it's fascinating, because many people don't know that that he literally connects all the three great tales, where that guy was, because you just see him as the forger of the rings. Sorry, my cat is going crazy. Sorry.
It's okay. I've got an invader.
You have the same problem with a tiny human.
Yes.
Yeah. And so I find that fascinating, that these characters we don't know that much about connect so many stories and so many lines.
Yeah. And that's the other cool thing, is just how he connects so many different things back and forth between each other. It's just, and this is why it took him so long to do it, because he had to make it all work plausibly.
Yes. Yeah.
That's cool. That's a massive editing job.
Yes. More than we have to do for our videos. But thank then goodness. He's immortal, you know, he's got time. Cool. So, Josh, thank you very much. I really love this discussion. You're always invited back. I think there will never be a day I don't think about a Tolkien topic. We will never run out of these topics, because people sometimes ask that, like, do you still have ideas for Tolkien? Like, yes, I just don't have the time.
Oh, I know. Yeah. Every now and then I start to think, like, what am I going to do for a topic? But then, like, 2 weeks later, I'll just have like five that I'm waiting to get to, and it never ends.
No. And I love that our community is growing and we're all connected. This is also what people always ask, like, and we literally became friends, which is so cool. And it's very nice and friendly, and we help each other and we talk to each other. And like you said, this is not competition. We just all love to geek about one topic. And several books. Good. So what's next for you? Your next video. Do you have anything dropping in the next days, weeks?
So yeah, my video on, hang on, let me actually check. I can't remember offhand what my video that is coming out on Monday is. I know I've got it done. Oh yeah. So it's a video on what do the eagles actually do in Middle Earth? Like, what are they doing besides just hanging out? And this was actually inspired by listening to the Tolkien professors exploring the Lord of the Rings, because he kind of gets into this a little bit too, and I'll explain that in the video. But yeah, stay tuned tomorrow. I always drop mine at midnight Central Time, U.S. Central Time, and so. Yeah, check out that video if you want to get my theory on what the eagles are there for and how it all kind of connects together.
Do you mention Numenor at all? Because they were in Numenor and they had an important role as well, and then they left and then Numenor drowned.
Yeah, I don't really get into the Numenor aspect of it because Numenor is kind of a special case. Yeah, and it really is not the same thing as what they're doing in Middle Earth. No, so I don't really get into that.
Yeah, good. Another video topic, Josh.
Yes.
What were the eagles doing in Numenor? Yeah. Cool. So thank you very much. I loved chatting with you. And yes, people, follow Tolkien Lore channel. Amazing videos. And I'm watching them. So recommendation from myself. And have a fabulous whatever day it is for you. Bye-bye, my lovelies. Yeah.
All right. It's been fun. Thanks.